Well, Coach, first and foremost, thank you so much for taking the time to sit down with us. As we get into preseason here, you've had, you know, a bit of time under your wings getting comfortable as a head coach for the Blazers. What has this fall camp been like so far?
You know, it's exceeded expectations. There's obviously unknown. I think you'd be lying to say that, one, everybody's not looking to see how this building's going to run under my leadership and probably skeptical at times. And I'd be lying to say that I had all the answers, you know? So it's not like I came in and I said, I know exactly what day 9 of training camp looks like. Like, that was never part of the plan, not a plan for where we would be through each stage of training camp. And I think leaning on a very, not an incompetence, that's a terrible thing to say, an unbelievable staff, listening, you know, not being a dictator, listening to suggestions, and then explaining my whys behind things has really allowed a nice collaboration to get us to what we feel is a very efficient and effective way of running training camp, and the kids respond. And that's always a litmus test, right? So you have all these cool things, you have all these cool sayings, you have all these great spreadsheets, you have all these great schedules and comms, but if the kids aren't responding well, then you're not doing it right. So our kids are responding really well. I think there's an energy that normally you don't see this deep into camp. There's an enthusiasm. There's a speed to which a NFL practice looks like, and I'm seeing it out there. So I couldn't be more pleased. Now, are we even close to where we need to be? Heck no. But we're making all the right steps. And so far, if you look at this like climbing Mount Everest, we've traversed more trail than we thought we were going to.
Pretty awesome day to have you here because some big announcements around 2 o'clock with the new jerseys. Can you talk about the new uniforms?
And I didn't even know it was being announced. So,
but what have you seen? It's coming out today. Ted was telling us. What have you seen about that? And what?
I think there's a story. I'll let everybody judge. I think they're cool. I made them, so I think they're really cool. Our kids loved them. So as affirmation as an old fart that actually the younger generation likes what I'm designing. So that was good. But the bigger story to it, which I thought was really impactful to be able to do the uniform release with our family and then explain the why was, you know, we're dedicating this entire home season to people that are hurting. In the past, we definitely wanted to carry Bill and the legacy of Children's Harbor. So that will be maintained and actually we're gonna try to do more with that. But then we've partnered with another really cool nonprofit that serves families, the entire family that are dealing with pediatric illness. And then we have the Benevolent Fund here at Lipscomb that serves a lot of people in need. So we're dedicating 3 home jerseys. We'll wear them twice each. So 6 games, twice each. And each game represents something bigger than ourselves. And our kids are getting that. They're like, yeah, it's more powerful when you're torturing yourself, which really training camp should be code-worded torture. You're torturing yourself for somebody else's benefit. Like, we play for something bigger than ourselves, and our home jerseys will represent that.
I just want to cut one more on that, and it means a lot to you. You're very vocal about what you went through, but even what Bill built, you're like, we're going to keep that, but I want to put more to it.
And I'll say this till the cows come home. What Bill did here, and what BV did last year, too, in a tough situation, they built a really strong foundation. Birmingham is very lucky for the leadership they've had here, the coaches they've had here, the foundation that's been built. Our job isn't to take away from that. That would be ignorant. Like, that'd be stupid. The Children's Harbor games are amazing. Like, I didn't, 3 years ago, I couldn't tell you much about UAB, right? But I watched that game, and I always asked, why are they wearing that what I thought it was a throwback or something. Why are they wearing that? And then their storytelling behind that. I think that's a powerful thing, and we want to just build off of some of the great things that those staffs did.
And talking about that, Trent, just your career as a player, you've been there at every level. You've coached at the high school level. Mm-hmm. Obviously, having the chance here to build, and as you're saying, to build from a foundation that's already here, mm-hmm. but how cool is it in this transitional period that we're in with college football for you to step into this arena and have a chance to create your own kind of look and feel to a program?
Yeah, and I said this in an article that was written recently. Like, I think we have a distinct advantage here. Really distinct, it's not a little advantage. We don't have the curmudgeon approach in this building of, oh, what college football was. And people go like, that's not a big a deal. Oh, it's a huge deal. Like, you go to any coaching conference this off season, you go to the AFCA, you go to whatever, it's Glazer Clinic, you go to Coach Saban speak at something, you, wherever you went this offseason, and all these conference meetings, all you hear is, woe is us. This is so hard. Oh my gosh, how do we deal with all this? And I'm looking back going, oh, we're kicking your butts, because we roll in going, how awesome is this? What an amazing opportunity. Yes, NIL, portal, challenges, give it to me. Like, let's go. This is where high performers thrive, is you don't look at problems, you look for solutions. And we don't know any different. There's not one conversation. Oh, remember the good old days? There are no good old days. Like, this is our day. And I think it's a massive advantage when this thing all nets out, and whatever we are, we are. And people have their, I promise you this, we will do that part well. Like, we will figure out this dynamic of what college football is on the kids' behalf. And I think that's where the real rubbing point is. I think your ADs, your presidents, your boosters, and your coaches are so caught up in the challenges, they forget about the primary person they should be serving, which is the kid. And we walk in this building every single day, and we're like, I'm not institutional centric. I'm not coach centric. I'm these seat centric. I'm gonna do what's ever best in the best interest of these kids, because that's our primary job. That's where the high school yellow school bus mentality really helps in this landscape, is you don't get lost. And people go, oh, he's the kumbaya coach. What about winning? We'll see.
Well, that's why we put you in those seats, so you could get the perspective of the kids.
I'm pretty competitive. You think you're more competitive than with me, people, then you got something coming.
Something with competitiveness. I read that ESPN article. It was really well written, and they kind of talked about you were getting frustrated with some of the flight stuff they were talking about. Yeah. And I mean, I'm sure you're sitting there.
No, I wasn't frustrated. It's just a reality.
It's a reality, right? Yeah. And talk to me about that. With, you have Nick Saban, which that's a different story, down the road. But Auburn, you've got Troy, but then in your conference now, this is a bigger league, and you want to match up to that.
You do, but the things that help these kids. And I think that's the difference is, again, I'll go back to coach-centric versus kid-centric. College football has become coach-centric. It's become institutional-centric. The kids are being left behind. They say, no, they're not. They're getting paid. No, but in the attention, like what really matters. And I don't care. Listen, I've flown private hundreds of times in my life. I don't need to fly private. I'll get on a Southwest A-list seat and sit in the best seat in the plane, right? The one that has all the leg room. I'll sit in an American seat, normal coach seat. I don't care, right? I'm going to get work done. I'm going to do winning things when I'm on that plane. I've lived that life. I've had the luxuries of life. There's not a luxury I haven't experienced in life. I will do anything it takes to help these kids. And if that means we're not going to devote resources to flying private for time efficiency or an extra staff meeting, and I get less sleep than the other coach gets, that's fine. I got no issues with that. Now, when it comes to resourcing the kid, I'm going to fight as hard as any person's ever fought in the history of fighting for these kids to be resourced so they can chase their potential. I don't need to chase my potential. Kind of got there, right? I want them to get there.
And on that real quick, I wanted to talk about what you've done with this building. I talked to Ted about really rebranding everything, and I saw in the article as well, part of your salary, putting in these staff members. Tell me about that.
Well, it's just something my wife and I felt was necessary. Like, it's public knowledge, so I don't feel bad telling, but we put $2.5 million back over 5 years, $500 a year. Into the coach's salary pool, because I've said it publicly, I think the most overrated person in the building is the head coach, except for who he hires. I can't talk today. And I wanted to make sure that they were resourced properly. And I wanted that hybrid staff. You know, I had some wants that aren't realities unless you give to the wants. To be able to have the robust support staff we have, the quality of analysts we have, you can't do that with the existing salary pool. So we had to make that salary pool bigger. And again, there's plenty of people made a lot more money than me, but football has given me more than I ever possibly could have imagined. I think it's my time to give back to football. And I did that at Lipscomb, and I'm doing it here. And sure, you should be compensated based on how good you do and all these different things, but the coach should be compensated. You know, you're going to see some incredible defensive stuff. You're going to see some incredible offensive stuff, some incredible special team stuff. It's from 30,000 feet, that's my stuff, but I'm not the one doing it 18 hours a day. You know, those guys doing it 18 hours a day need to be compensated. So It's just the right thing to do, and we'll continue to do it as long as I coach.
And that's awesome, the changes that you're kind of immediately bringing to this program. And with your unique perspective and one being spending time at ESPN, knowing how to be comfortable on a mic, you don't always see that with coaches, and you don't always see that in college football. What has been the reception for how candid you've been in these early press conferences?
Yeah, I've heard the word bold. Like, and I'm like, I don't really think I'm being
bold. Candid.
Candid, I think, is correct. Transparent.
Yeah.
Outside the box.
Well, but that's just being me. Like, I'm not trying to be a contrarian. Like, Colin Cowher and I are really good friends, and we talk all the time. He is a contrarian. Like, he's looking for the other side. And I think that's what makes him brilliant, is he's going to make you think about something that's not a common narrative. I look at football that way. I definitely look at football that way because I think it's an advantage, but I'm not trying to be that with these issues. I'm just being honest. I think what happens in football, like I have a 42-year-old football life, right? From an 8-year-old on the back of a blocking sled, all the different things, and now a college coach. The one common denominator is that coaches are full of crap, usually. It's called coach speak. So I think what when you get just truth, like this is actually what we're doing. Well, you're not supposed to be telling us that, coach. Why? Like, just telling you how we're doing things. You can disagree, you can agree, you can fight over the water cooler. I don't really care. I'm just going to tell you how we're doing things. That's called bold. Like, no, I'm just telling you the truth.
Yeah.
Like when Nick gets up, I think Nick's brilliant in front of the camera because he gets up and he says, no, this is what I'm teaching my kids. Mm-hmm. You might not be teaching your kids this, but this is what I'm teaching my kids. Oh, that seems so. No, this is why we win and win and win and win. That's why we keep pumping kids in the NFL, because we're teaching them the right stuff. You might think culturally it's inappropriate, but in this building, Nick's building, this is how you get excellent. And this is what the standards we hold him to. And I love when he gets after a media guy that tries to get in the middle of his team, because he's not mad at that media guy. He's just like, hey, idiot, you don't get it. Like, no, this is what we do. And they're coming out better because of it. Just because you don't agree with it, we don't care what you think. Like, this is what we're doing. And I kind of just take that approach. I'm not Belichickian. I know how to be Belichickian if I want to be. You know, I could do that easily. I did that at ESPN at times. But I don't think we're trying to create an energy and excitement in the city for the Blazers. Like, I get it. You should still Roll Tide. You should still War Eagle. But there's a lot of people down here looking for the Blazers to be their team, their tribe, their home. I want them to know what's really going on. And some of them will be like, I don't really like that bald old guy, but at least he tells me the truth. You know, and they'll be like, I don't necessarily agree with that, but boy, it worked. Maybe I should think about that. I just want them to know who we are. There's no surprises. Like, this is who we're going to be.
Fire breathers are all about. I just had to put that in there.
No, and the one thing that I respect about when you went to the American Media Day is you were very honest. And you said, look, I'm not going to go with this new world. You're not going to say new coach. I'm going to try to poach your players. And that was something that you were vocal about. And then this hasn't stopped. I've heard some things. There's another player that jumped in the portal, mm-hmm. and he hasn't really been here recently. But this hasn't stopped.
It's not going to stop. You know, I mean, tampering is a huge piece of college football right now. You know, and I understand it to a certain degree. You know, the Power Five line is don't hate the player, hate the game. You know, that's what they'll all say, whether it's a booster, it's a coach or whatever. Hey, don't hate the player, hate the game. This is what's going on. And I'm like, well, the game's cheating. I mean, like, you're evaluating my roster. They're my kids. They're not in the portal, right? They want to be here. And you're luring, what's the word? Help me.
Luring,
right?
Yeah,
them
right, yeah.
out of a situation they're good in for the hopes of it being better. Some are empty promises. A lot of these portal kids are not getting what they're supposed to get when they get there, because a lot of people don't understand the 4-for-4 transfer rule. When you transfer from a four-year institution to another four-year institution, until you graduate, you cannot go anywhere. So a lot of these kids are being told at, let's say, School X, Group of Five program, hey, you leave, you got $100,000 coming. So a kid goes, he signs his paperwork to now be an official student athlete at another institution. Where's the $100,000? They don't have to give it to him. He can't go anywhere. They can't sue him. They can't do anything. They just were promised something, but that it didn't come to fruition. And that's happening often. You're also seeing players from Group of Fives that have NFL draft grades because they have 800 reps at said Group of Five program. and they're being told, oh, you're going to come play at Power 5 glamorous brand school, right? And the NFL scouts are going to see you more often. Well, no, they're not when you went to 250 snaps instead of 800 snaps. And by the way, all of as many scouts come through this building that go through the buildings south and west of here, right? We just as many. So that's a lie too. So there's a lot of manipulation and lying to who do I care most about? Them.
Right.
Now, there will be instances, because we have some very talented players. I'm not going to say it publicly, but I got 5-6 players in my head right now that will be worth a lot of money next year. And their NFL grade might not be high enough to justify going to the NFL. If I can't make the situation here as good for them, I will walk them out the door. You know what I mean? I will absolutely walk. Now, it's going to hurt like heck to lose that type of player, that type of kid. But that's the right thing to do for the kid. Now, I think there's one more. If that kid, it's good for him both NFL future and immediate money future. Now, if it's just immediate money, not NFL, then I think I'd say, you know what's best for you? For less money, stay here and improve your draft stock, because that's real wealth. NIL is not real wealth, everybody, in these guys' world, yeah. Right? Some of these people in these chairs will be multi-millionaires if they do it right. That's real wealth. That's generational wealth. NIL is not generational wealth. It's new car wealth. It's pay your bills wealth. It's Jordan shoes wealth. You know what I mean? Like, let's talk about the real now that I haven't heard another coach talk about. Let me help you get to the league. Live the life that I lived. My grandkids' private school's paid for. My great-grandkids' private school's paid for, if that's what they want to do. Family vacations are paid off generationally. Homes are paid off. No debt in your life. That's generational wealth. Some of these people have the chance to make generational wealth if they choose the place that is best for their long-term future. NIL is not talking about that.
How do you stop poaching?
This is my strategy. Like, you're looking at the strategy, right? Go public with it. Be honest about it. Let the other coaches call and cuss at you on the phone and then hang up on them. Like, I don't care what they think. Don't poach my players. Don't care who you are. Don't care how many games you've won, things you have. I'm pretty confident my football life's been as robust as yours. Not intimidated by you. Don't care what conference you're in. Stay out of my roster. Stay out of my roster. And if I find you in my roster, I have met with NCAA head of NIL compliance. They've been in my office. They're on speed dial right now. I'm going to call and report you. I got DMs. I got WhatsApps. I got text threads. Now, you still might beat me at it. You might have a great deal with a third party that's doing the whole thing that I can't trace. You beat me at it. Great. I'm going to try.
Yeah,
I'm going to go down swinging.
And with that mindset, I mean, it's refreshing to hear that from a coach. As I said, we're getting a new look at, I think, what head coaches may become in college football. And was there at all any pressure? I'm assuming not. But just to be here, you know, literally Birmingham, it's headquarters of SEC. You have all of this kind of target on the culture of football here. And you're trying to build something, but also, I mean, calling out something that's probably been done for years, but now there's a new spotlight. Was that the draw to come to this job, or is there any kind of excitement, I guess, for you?
I love the SEC, so I'm kind of an SEC junkie myself. Like, I was a high school coach. I'd sit and game plan all weekend, and I watched all the SEC games. I had a lot of Elite 11 quarterbacks that I mentored that were playing in the SEC, so I'm actually a huge fan of the SEC. I really like some of these coaches. I know some of these coaches. They're great dudes. I've learned more football studying Alabama in the last 5 years and probably as much as I did studying the NFL. So there's a lot of great to the SEC. I'm not talking about the SEC. I'm talking about the rat race, which has become roster management at the next level. And that's great. You got your challenges. You go get after them. I support you 100% wherever you're at, group Power 5. Just don't mess with mine. Hey, I ain't going to call you out if you mess with somebody else's. It's not my roster. Chip Kelly taught me a very valuable lesson, and I think he'd probably be listening to me going, I don't know if you're really taking my advice, but I am. He said, don't get caught up in what everybody else is doing. It's a hard enough job managing your building. But that's really what I'm doing. You know, I mean, I'm not worried about what they're doing. I'm just saying stay out of my building. And everybody's like, well, he's caught up in all this. No, I'm not. I'm protecting my house, you know, and you can't protect your house unless in today's world, unless you address that, because that's what the world's listening to. Right?
Yeah.
That you guys are as powerful as anybody right now by what questions you ask, because people are depending on this for their answers. And I'm giving you my answer. Like, I am protecting this house, and that's how I'm protecting it.
How do you make it work at UAB on a Saturday? I know there's a lot of Thursday games, and that Thursday home opener is going to be special. I sat down with Bill Clark about a month ago. Mm-hmm. He's been great to us, and he said, we even had a scenario where we thought all Thursday games. What is your plan? I mean, because it's no secret. You said War Eagle, Roll Tide, but you can be a Blazers fan as well.
Yeah, and the as well thing I think is important. I think that's a part of it, okay? I think there's plenty of people that are football fans in the Southeast that went to Auburn, went to Alabama. That's their baby, as it should be, by the way. Okay, like, you should be. I'm not trying to take you away from your alma mater. But you're like, you know what? UAB football is really good for Birmingham. I have a business in Birmingham. My kids go to school in Birmingham. You know, we should support that. I think that's a part of this. I think there's a bunch of people in Birmingham that don't feel attached to Roll Tide or War Eagle. And for whatever reason, they haven't felt attached to UAB football. Those are my people. Those are people that's why I'm living downtown. That's why I'm going to restaurants downtown. That's why you'll see me in every elementary school downtown and junior high and high school and all that stuff. That's why you'll see me in, you know, I am trying to be that coach, the coach of that group. I don't know where they live. I don't know Birmingham well enough. I'm going to go find where they live and where they go to school. And I want you to buy into this, right? And I think that's what we need. And then the other part is important. I think it's cool that you can be War Eagle and still root for the Blazers and be Go Blazers. But that place, Protective, gets gnarly now when it's Birmingham's team, right? And Cole Peterson, our DFO, has done a great job with his Birmingham boys and 205 and 99 Burrows. And like, and we're going to take our kids up before the season starts. I'm going to take them up to the Vulcan. I'm going to overlook, and I'm going to say, hey, that's what you're playing for. Like, that's those people down there. That's what we're playing for. Those are our people. Those are going to be the people in those stands. Those are people we're going to go serve their kids at their schools. We're going to go to Glen Iris and pick up trash. And we're going to go to Parker and fix the track. And we're going to keep doing these things because we want to serve those people, because those people are going to be attached to you. You can be those kids' heroes, right? And now I don't think the Saturday 2:30 starts a big deal. Because I'm going to be honest with you. If I went to Alabama and they were playing on TV and I couldn't get to Tuscaloosa, or I couldn't get to wherever these other SEC schools are to watch the game, I ain't leaving my couch. I love my couch on Saturday afternoons. When I was coaching high school football, man, I game planned for like 12 hours. My family, you know, I didn't get out of my pajamas till like midnight the next night. And I watched all that TV, and I had my chips and dip, all that stuff. Like, they should not go to Protective. If you're an Alabama alum and your team plays at 2:30, you should watch them. That's not who I'm trying to get. I wonder if you didn't go to Alabama, you didn't go to Auburn, you live in this city, you know this team is going to do something great for your city, then get your tail to Protective. We're going to make the experience awesome, and we're going to give you a product that you are going to be really, really proud of.
Coach, with all these visions in mind, my last question for you as we approach the season here, you want to develop players, you mm-hmm. want to build those relationships, you want to build this fan base. If you have an expectation by the end of year one, what's maybe the most important thing on that list, looking at all of the stuff that you're trying to kind of form here?
So this is going to sound like coach speak, but as you're asking the question, I'm thinking how it's not coach speak. I want us all to be significantly better than we are right now. Okay, it starts with our team. If we play our best football game the end of the year, whatever that last game is, I will be happy as a lark. Great football, you get better as the year goes on. And what you'll see in college football, you see a lot of teams that will get worse. We're going to get better. Okay, so that's the team. Coaches. Coaches will develop. Okay, this building will develop. We'll be better at the end of the year as a building than we're at the beginning of the year. But the fan base can get better too. The energy can get better. The media can buy in more. The administration can get better. Like, I want us all to be better. So at the end of the year, you're going to look back and say, was that a good hire on December 1st? Well, you can look at some objective stuff, but then subjectively, I want you to look at and say, okay, a year later, are we better?
Any pressure with that?
I love pressure.
Okay. Only solutions.
When you've been booed out of stadiums, when you've woken up the next morning when there was newspapers and everything was bad, or the internet and everything's bad, and there ain't no such thing as pressure. Like, I'm gonna be me. I'm gonna do me. I'm gonna serve these kids. I believe we have the right process in place, and then I'll own whatever bad happens, and I'll probably deflect the credit if good stuff happens.
Two more from me. Wanted to talk about, every time I wake up, it seems like there's a new school and a new conference. You guys, I feel like, landed, in my opinion, at the right place at the right time.
Agreed.
How do you feel about what's going on in college football? How do you feel about where, because easily some people say, ooh, the Blazers could be in the Pac-12 maybe. Like, you know, where do you think you're in the right spot right now?
I don't think that conference exists anymore.
She went to Arizona State. Yeah. So
I can't control those things. This is going to sound esoteric, but this last 5 years of my life, I am steadfast on worrying about things I can control. I can't control that stuff. I don't care. That's my statement. I don't care really is me saying I can't control it. Right. So why would I devote any emotional or intellectual energy to it? Every emotional or intellectual moment I spend on doing something I can't control takes away from what I can do in this building. Now, the American question is a great question. I feel extremely fortunate that we got into the American. I think the USA, they had outgrown the USA. I think the American has way more to offer. Now watching the Pac-12 disintegrate, we really are a Power 5 conference. I think that needs to be the next narrative. Not where are we going? Why aren't we a Power 5 conference?
Why can't you be?
We should be. Like, that's the one that I'm going to say is like, I don't care about going to. I read an article by Goodman the other day. I thought it was a really good article. Like, Big Ten should get UAB because it's an SEC country, TV, Birmingham, biggest TV market in the country for college football. All that sounds cool, and I'm not saying it's a bad article. But no, it's a very simple solution. We are a Power 5 school. Resources like Power 5 schools.
Right.
Give us a $25 million allotment for being a Power 5 school. Give it to Tulane. Tulane proved it last year. They're better than some of the Power 5 schools. So I think the discussion is make us a Power 5 conference now that that other conference is disintegrated, which it has. It's not going back. Oh. So in 2024, college playoff expanded to 12 teams. It's a perfect transition to make the American the Power 5th conference.
Do you have to?
Does that make it Power 5th? Yeah, Power 5th.
Do you have to win the American next year to make the playoff, or do you think there's a shot?
Yeah, I think you have to win the American. Yeah, I have high aspirations, and we're setting our standards very high here, but we also know that there's a win-loss component to that. I think you gotta win them all.
Yeah.
I'll be honest with you. Because here's what's going to happen is politics will take over, and you know, you're going to get a four-loss SEC school in before you get a Mountain West or American team that's got one or two losses. So yeah, you got to win it, and I think I won all your games.
Yeah. My last one is just, you talked about the community before we went on and how much you love Birmingham, and just tell me about it. Tell me about, you touched a little bit that you're living downtown. What is, you're going to see Trent Dilfer at restaurants,
everywhere.
Your wife, your family comes.
She's
here.
A smoke show, by the way, so you'll know when we're in a restaurant. Who's the ugly bald dude with that smoke show? Oh, that's Coach Dilfer and his wife, who looks 20 years younger than
him. Do you get out a lot, or are you a...
We are. We started when I was playing, date night once a week. But then there's probably a couple. We're a morning team, so we'll have some evenings, probably Thursday, Friday. Friday of home games, Thursday every week, where we'll get out. Off-season, I'm out all the time. But yeah, I like being out and about. I don't like VIP treatment. Like, I don't care about all that stuff. I want to sit at a table like anybody else. I want to go to a movie. I want to do whatever normal people do. I'm normal, and I like to meet people. I like when people come up to me and introduce themselves and tell me their stories. I'll sit at a bar at La Fresca and make conversation with the guy next to me about what his story is, and when my wife's not in town. I enjoy that piece. I really, really do. Here's what I like most about Birmingham. The food, obviously, it's why I gained 30 pounds at first when I got
here. But you lost it.
I lost it, but I did. Ooh, that was rough. I was told a bunch of people this. I told my golf buddies, I started playing golf again, and I was telling my golf buddies this. I've never been more impressed with the realness of a community You know, I've lived, you know, it's probably that I'm jaded because being a California guy, like nobody's real in California. Like you're reading through all the facades to get to the real person. Nashville became that towards the end. You know, it's kind of got a Hollywood flair to it. Now, mm-hmm. Austin was that way. You know, we thought we were getting to Texas to kind of be around normal folks, and it was California all over again. So, you know, California for nine while I'm working at ESPN, retired from the Niners. Austin thinking we're getting away from it, didn't get away from it. Nashville the first 2 years was nice, and then it turned into, you know, Hollywood, Southeast. And I get here, I'm like, this is too good to be true. Like, these are our people. Like, doesn't matter where they live, what restaurant you're at, what environment you're at, they're just who they are. And that's really refreshing. That's been the piece that I'll look in the camera and say, that's what I loved about this city, is I feel like I've been treated honestly and well, and I feel like I've gotten the best of everybody I've met in this town.
Well, Coach, thank you so much for your time.
I appreciate you guys. Thank you.
Thank you.